Hello, everyone. Thank you again for taking the time to join our webinar. I'm thrilled to be here today with Doc Searls. You know, he has many accolades and as always has been just a great proponent of the internet and considering kind of the consumer. And in today's day and age, when I think there's a groundswell of interest around how can we better provide a better experience to consumers, but also protect the privacy around consumers, Doc has really taken a real strong interest in this. So it's really great to have you here, Doc, and welcome.
It's great to be here. Thank you.
So before we kick off, right, and this is going to be just for the audience out there, this is going to be 55 minutes of just kind of really interesting conversation between Doc and I. But just to kick off and kind of set the stage, I wanted to make sure everybody on the phone really understood the topic and what we're planning to talk about here today. You know, if you think about if you think about a couple of things, the fact that consumers today are asking for really more access and control to their own personal information and how it's being used, you know, coupled with the fact that businesses are trying to get their hands on as much data about a consumer as possible so that they could deliver a more personalized experience, it's really created kind of a groundswell of interest around how can we kind of strike a better balance between consumer privacy and then also being able to drive consumer personalization. And I think when you think about new regulations that are coming out, especially around the European Union's General Data Protection Regulation, or better known as GDPR, it's really fundamentally a regulation that matters to everyone. Even though it might have, you know, the modifier in there of the European Union, it really does affect any organization, any business that conducts transactions with European citizens and therefore stores citizens' personal data from the European Union. And so when you think about this regulation, you have to ask yourself, you know, what's at stake? Well, first off, if you don't know or if you're unaware, GDPR will become into effect on May 25th, 2018. This was something that was declared, I think, almost now a year and a half ago in 2016. And as a result, the next question is, well, who does this apply to? And as I said, it's any entity processing personal data of EU citizens. So you could be a North American operation, a North American business, and if you conduct business in any one of the countries in the European Union, you know, you are subject to having to comply to GDPR. And if you don't, we know that the penalties are severe. It can be for any infraction can be up to 20 million euros or 4% of annual revenue, annual turnover, whichever is greater. So, you know, this is kind of a quick summary of what's at stake. Now, the next question is, you know, well, what is GDPR really focused on? Well, there's plenty of new rules. There's over 300 pages of various articles, you know, affecting how and thinking about how one should process customer data, how one should store customer data, the right people and personnel you should have that is responsible for that. But there's also a core aspect around the individual rights. And this is the individual rights of that European citizen. And you may hear the terminology being used called where an individual is called a data subject. So there's a set of individual rights, and these rights can be summarized as the following. You have every individual has the right to be informed about how their customer data is being used. They need the right of access to understand how their personal data is being used. They have the right to do things like be able to withdraw any kind of consent that they may have previously given and the fact that they must have known that they've given that consent. They have the right to do things like freeze their account with the business that they're dealing with. They have the right to delete their account with the business that they're dealing with. And they also have the right to download their own personal data and use it as they see fit. There's just a number of these individual rights around GDPR, and that needs to be balanced as well as an organization. You have to think about those individual rights, how you're going to service those individual rights, as well as have the responsibilities that you have, right? Which is, are you able to capture consent and proof of consent throughout the relationship with your customer? Do you have the right personnel in place? GDPR requires that you have a data protection officer to monitor internal compliance. And especially in today's day and age, and over the past few years, you know, data breaches have become more prolific. And so there needs to be a process and a communication procedure in place in order to notify the EU authorities of when a data breach occurs. So as you can think, here are some core tenets. There's core tenets around individual rights, and there's core tenets around the organization's responsibilities. So with that kind of quick introduction, Doc, you know, I really want to ask you this question. You know, what are some of the hurdles you see marketers and organizations in general face as a result of GDPR?
Boy, there are so many of them. But the biggest one, and the one that's being talked least about, is the simple fact that the power is shifting away from organizations into individuals. This was implicit in the internet in the first place, in the essentially peer-to-peer nature of it, the way it was designed in the first place. And what's already being done by individuals to claim some agency, which is the power to act in the world, on their own. And probably the biggest of these is ad blocking and tracking protection, which often comes with ad blocking. There are a lot of different numbers on this, but the one that I think is most trustworthy is about 1.7 billion people are blocking ads online right now. That didn't happen in a vacuum. That happened because people didn't like being tracked. The rise in ad blocking actually correlates very closely with the rise in tracking-based ad tech. And what's going to happen, I think, along with the GDPR coming into effect, is a lot of the controls that we are going to have as individuals are going to be on our side. It's not just that we're going to have many different ways to consent provided by companies, but rather we're going to have tools of our own for doing that. Those are going to emerge, I think, especially as the GDPR takes effect. But companies need to be ready to welcome that kind of thing. So far, like with ad blocking, that's entirely... it's negative, it's prophylactic, it's not very engaging, but we're going to get tools for engagement. And as we get those, marketing is going to need to get normalized around how that works. Part of that's going to be consent that goes the other way, with the individual acting as the first party saying, these are my terms and these are my conditions and these are how the ways my data can be used. And that actually can also provide GDPR compliance. So a lot of the answers to the compliance question are going to come from recognizing that the first party is going to be the individual and not just the company.
Yeah, really interesting. And I think another thing to consider as part of this, right? I think the fundamental insight that organizations are gaining about their customers is really derived from the data that they're collecting. And I think you're making that point of, you know, today a lot of the data that is used to drive a lot of the marketing mechanisms is data that is not necessarily acquired firsthand directly from the customer. It's data that can be inferred. And typically in this industry, it's called third-party data that's being used, right? A compilation of data aggregated over time that assembles and kind of assembles various segments or groups of people and their affinities that is then used to drive targeting. But let's focus in a little bit more on that concept of data, because I think it's really interesting. In fact, you know, you wrote in a recent blog article about your about data and how it's used. And in fact, I think typically for many years in the industry, data has always been associated to crude or the new oil. You actually have a disdain for that metaphor that data is the new oil. In fact, instead, you actually prefer to say that data is the new love. Can you explain that a little bit more?
Yeah,
in terms of what you mean?
I think if you look at personal data as the as our lifeblood, as it were, data is what flows through the machinery we use in order to enhance our lives in the connected world. Most of that is not useful to other people. It's useful to us. It's our own financial data. It's our own health data. It's our own list of people that we contact. It's the notes that we take. And we should be able to share some of that on a need-to-know basis. But the difference between oil, which is a commodity, an extracted commodity, that's, you know, it's scarce. It's rivalrous, to use an economics term. Data is very different. Data effervesces. We don't send data. We duplicate it. If you send me an email, you've just copied it over to my machine. You still have a copy of it. It's very different that way. And love is sort of like that too. I mean, it's sort of a squishy way to put it. But the thing is that it's something we care about and we share very selectively with people we trust on the understanding that they're going to use it well. And there's so many ways we can go here, but we've only been on the internet and using digital technology the way we are now really for only about 22 years since April of 1995. That's when the last of the backbone providers of the internet itself stopped forbidding one kind of traffic, which is commercial. And once that went down, suddenly everything could be shared everywhere. Part of the problem for marketing is that two things got conflated, and it's unfortunate that they did. And one was plain old advertising. And advertising was never personal. Advertising was always to populations. It always sponsored a medium. You advertised on the game, you advertised in the paper, you advertised on a radio show, and you're advertising to a group of people defined by that medium. And that was understood very well, and it sponsored that medium. There's another thing that marketing did, which is called direct marketing, which wanted data, always wanted data, always lived off third-party data from companies like Axiom. Some of it obtained, you might call it legitimately, you know, you get a hunting license. Part of the terms of getting the license is they can share that data or sell it. But it was always in order to develop these very personal profiles. And once the internet was in the middle of this, we went nuts with that. Marketing went completely nuts with it. And direct marketing basically took over advertising. And what we call advertising online now, the digital advertising, ad tech, programmatic, all this stuff is basically direct marketing now. It's not advertising as it used to be. And with it went with the big data craze starting about 2012, and large companies such as IBM and SAP and Oracle and the rest selling big data services to companies, all for the purpose of getting better and better and better and better marketing data on the fiction that you could hit the perfect person at the perfect time with the perfect message, as if anybody ever wanted that. There's a reason that people will stick a no junk mail notice on their mailbox, which, by the way, has no effect whatsoever. There's nothing that stops junk mail that way. And in fact, the post office, all the post offices of the world have made a lot of their money. They would be out of business without junk mail. The same thing has happened online. The thing is that because of the nature of digital life, it went completely crazy. It was like the Sorcerer's Apprentice. We couldn't stop it. And that's one reason why we have the GDPR. We have laws that are saying, wait a minute, your manners marketing are horrible and we have to fix that. In the meantime, we have just the beginning of things coming in from the customer side to start thwarting that. But the positive way of looking at this is volunteered personal data is far more valuable than the kind that's extracted or obtained from third parties, and treating people as if they're an oil field. I mean, I should just add this one thing. I mean, one of the things that appalled me when I was even in the business, in the marketing business many years ago, was that the language that we used in talking about people betrayed a mentality that was not really very helpful. We called them targets. We said we acquired them. We manage them. We control them. We lock them in. If you go to get a VC, they're going to say to your startup, what's your lock-in, right? As if people want to be locked. They don't. And we have the opportunity not to be locked on the net. So if we're unlocked, how do we relate to people? How do we relate to the companies that we want to share relevant and useful data with? And I think that's much more generous by nature. But we're going to have to get over a lot of the effects of having acted poorly on the marketing side for a number of years.
Yeah, and I think you're starting to see that a lot. I mean, if you know, you were mentioning and talking about how marketing has evolved over the time and kind of what advertising was maybe in the Mad Men years to where advertising is today. And this is by no means, kind of trying to knock on advertising, but I think maybe there's perhaps an enlightenment that should be happening right now, especially with how these various solutions are being able to handle the implications of things like GDPR. I mean, fundamentally, do you think GDPR is an extinction event for ad tech in Europe, and not necessarily kind of an Armageddon style type event, but something that unless drastic change is done, you know, we're going to see some effects that are happening to the way ad tech is being used and deployed in the EU?
Well, I think it is. If one goes to Europe and goes to trade shows there, every single booth, every single speaker deals with the GDPR. And it's not without cause. I mean, there is to begin with in Europe a much higher degree of sensitivity about privacy. There's a great deal of resentment, especially toward Google and Facebook, not only for their gigantic nature but the fact that they've harvested a great deal of data about us and are using it, whether it's by law. Without permission, essentially, even if we have signed something. And by the way, it's interesting that Facebook has a head of privacy that's worldwide and a different one for the U.S. The U.S. is way, 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 way behind in many ways on privacy. We are not a very privacy-conscious society, at least in business, and that's very much the case in Europe, and they're very sensitive about it. But what's going to happen, I think, is, to use the extinction event metaphor, is that the GDPR is like the Chicksa Club asteroid hitting, and the dinosaurs didn't die off. The birds survived. There are going to be birds that survive here, but the wanton collection of personal data for the purpose of hitting people everywhere with guesswork about what they might want. Is going to fail, and it's already failing anyway, simply because it's full of fraud and malware. I know people getting out of the business now. I mean, just punching out of the business, the ad tech business, very successful people in that business, because they know the end is near. They know what's coming. It's not, you can't even begin to get investment in that right now. You might get third round, let's keep this thing alive type investing, but nobody can go into an ad tech startup right now. There's no money. There's no. You're not going to get any investment in it because everybody's looking at the GDPR, and you cut that kind of funding off, and that's already an extinction event of a sort.
Yeah, yeah, no kidding. And in fact, I think there's a couple of other pundits and research analysts as well that are kind of really trying to shed some more light on this. In fact, I think Forrester just recently published an article really stating the fact that, you know, while GDPR, while you may think GDPR is going to affect kind of the large, kind of very public organizations, maybe like a Facebook or a Google or a whatnot, it's really, it very well may sink its claws into the ad tech vendors and even MarTech vendors in exactly how they're handling GDPR, how they're handling consumer consent, how they're protecting that information, and how they're addressing those individual rights, like we talked about. And I'm gonna imagine here and assume and see that this dialogue is only going to increase, especially as we're, you know, what, less than 7-8 months running up to when GDPR is going to take effect. And kind of to that next point, do you believe, you know, we talked about ad tech, talked about ad blocking, talked about third party data, you know, do you really think there's any difference to marketing tech in terms of how, what they need to address, or is it much of the same?
Well, Scott Breaker of who hosts the annual MarTech conference produces this poster that has 5,000 plus participants on it. It started with like 100 something, and this is like the MarTech sphere. Meanwhile, Terrence Kawaja of Luma Partners produces the Lumascapes, which I'm sure many of you have seen. That's a smaller version of the same thing, and it really started with the Lumascapes, by the way. And that's a much smaller subset. So ad tech is a subset of MarTech, and I think that's always going to be the case. Ad tech is the thing that's in the crosshairs of the GDPR primarily. I think but MarTech is there to the degree that it's holding a lot of data. A lot of that data is the kind of data that, you know, a person wants it back or something, and they're still within the scope of the GDPR and what the GDPR is going to require of them. So being ready for the GDPR is a big deal for all of MarTech, to the degree that they have a lot of customer data. I think one of the things that and this just actually occurs to me now. I mean, they're some of the most successful companies have no customer data at all. You know, like Trader Joe's, for example, not only has no customer data, they have no marketing to speak of. They just do a better job, and they make it as uncomplicated as possible to shop there. Zara is another one that's like that. And but where I'm going with this is that it may actually pay some companies to say, you know what, we're wiping it clean. We're blowing it all up. We have no customer data now. We're starting over. We're going to start with the GDPR. Hey, customer, what do you want us to know about you? And that may actually be a better way for some companies. I know I read a story that one of the big consulting firms that had been advising companies to acquire all the customer data they could, or consumer data in the case of people who aren't paying, and are now being paid millions of dollars by those same companies to help them find where they put that data, because it's like this toxic asset, the radon gas of the company that's silent, you know, it's the silent killer that puts them at risk. I mean, there were stories before about data leakage through hackers, but what's going to happen when all of a sudden some customer says, well, wait a minute, you said you had no data on me, you had this data and I asked for it, you didn't have it. Well, but you actually had it, I found out, right? I mean, what happens when that comes up? I don't know. I mean, these are scenarios I think that we ought to be thinking about. But the key thing I think for marketing is to start looking for leadership coming from the customer side. You know, what is it the customers are coming to us for? What are they eager to reveal? What do they want us to know? What do they want us to share? You know, I buy one Sony TV. I've had it for 5 years. I've had these troubles with it. Or, you know, I get another one. Well, I'm still a customer. That record is important to me, and it's nice that the company's keeping it. We have that with some companies like Apple, for example. You know, I mean, they know all of the computers I've had, and it's helpful for them, I suppose, to know some of that, to know, you know, which iPhones I've had. I'm telling way too much about my life here. But the, you know, there's, you know, start looking toward what kind of information is shared in a genuine relationship rather than a coerced one. I mean, for example, probably I go to CVS more than the other drugstores. But I would like to know, but I have prescriptions and I shop at all of them, and I have ones at multiple drugstores. I'd like to be able to, you know, control all those relationships as one tool. I would like to, you know, the only thing I really care about with any of the drugstores is my prescriptions. I don't really want to get promotions for the bags of chips I could buy on my way to the pharmacy counter, or I don't want them guessing at me that I need NyQuil because I have a cold now, because they have a deal with NyQuil to push that stuff at me under those conditions. I think that how customers actually use companies is going to become much more interesting than the direct marketing based guesswork that we brought into the digital world from the old junk mail world, and really needs to be thrown out. We need to look at relationship with customers in an entirely new way that's not just permitted, but actually led by customers.
I couldn't agree with you more. And I think what fundamentally that is that, you know, the conversation that we've had today, whether it's, you know, that the type of data that's being used, the way that data has been acquired, how that's then pulled together to try and determine who a customer is, and driving that personalized experience, and doing so in a way that's inferred, doing so in a way that's not directly consented to by a customer, is really a symptom of what I call an overall problem that I think we're facing today. And I think in order to build trusted two-way relationships, in order to build a relationship between a brand, a client, a brand, and a business, and their consumers and users, is really by delivering what we call a value for information exchange. That you as a business should be delivering some form of value that is appropriate for the point in time you're at in the relationship with your consumer, and in return, the consumer will bring back and deliver back to you information or interests about themselves. But in order to build that trusted relationship, you need two fundamental things. You need transparency in the way that you operate as an organization, in the way that you interact with your consumers as an organization, in the way that you use the data about your customers in order to deliver them, whether that's new services, new products, or new experiences. And on the other hand, you need control. Control in the sense that a consumer, a user, needs to feel like they are in control of the personal data about themselves that's being used, that they're in control to be able to change the way that personal data is being used about themselves. And if when you have these two things, then you could really start building that foundation for a trusted relationship. And in fact, consumers are demanding this. And we've been talking about this since the beginning. But recently, Accenture did a report on looking across and surveying thousands of respondents consumers who operate and interact with e-commerce or retail sites, and said that, you know, 70% of consumers are fine with companies using their personal data if they know how that data is being used, right? So that really speaks to the whole transparency point. And moreover, more than 70%, it was three-fourths of consumers say that they have no problem with organizations using their data to deliver a better experience if customers have control over that data. And I think that's really telling. And there's many ways that we can deliver better transparency, and we could deliver better control. But so far today, it's really been challenging. What are your thoughts on that, Doc, in terms of, you know, being able to build a trusted relationship, and transparency and control are kind of core tenets to that?
Well, I think the best guidance we have on that are the norms that we've long had in the physical world. So for example, you know, every time we go to a restaurant and we pay by credit card, we expose personal data to the server, to the restaurant itself, and we expect that they're not going to say, you know, the server is not going to look at your card and say, thank you, Mr. Jones, for a good evening, and that they're not going to keep that data, that they're going to respect the inherent privacy of the customer, that there's so much information that we could be shedding in the everyday world that we don't, simply because other people and companies have manners. And frankly, we don't need to be known to the rest of the world. One grace of civilization is that we don't wear name tags as we walk down the street, and we don't wear, you know, things that say, here is everything you need to know about me, companies that I don't know. But because what can be done with technology will be done until we get laws and norms that correct them. We went, you know, we being marketing, went completely nuts with the simple fact that we could harvest this data. And what's, you know, what you're showing with these two charts is really just that customers are just simply looking for norms in the online world that reflect the ones that we have in the everyday world, in the physical world, where it's good that other people don't know everything about us. It's good that companies don't know everything about us. And it's better that when we have genuine relationships, they're based on the individuals having some degree of control. Say, I'll let you know this much about me, and I'm not going to let you know these other things, because it's a, you know, not just because it's a matter of personal privacy, but in many ways, it's also because it's a waste of time. And again, you know, we've had 10,000 years to work these things out in the physical world, and we've had 22 in the online world. I mean, if you look at privacy technology, clothing and shelter are privacy technology. If we're wearing clothes, we are wearing privacy technology. We don't have clothing and shelter online yet. And, you know, we have a law first about it. You know, in the physical world, the laws arose to reinforce the norms that we had had there, but it's going the other way first here with the GDPR. So I think that's sort of the, you know, a sort of general way of answering that. Do you want me to answer any of the questions that are going by on the Q&A, because some of them need answering, I think.
We will, Doc. I mean, we definitely will tackle these questions at the end of our dialogue. What we have, just for everybody on the call, thank you for submitting your questions. Keep them coming. At the end, we're saving time, around 10 minutes or so, to answer these questions. But let's go ahead and continue on with our conversation here. Fundamentally, I'm seeing it as well, right? And I think, you know, especially when you look at some of the big social media giants that are out there today, Facebook, Snapchat, Google, you know, they are the ones who, honestly, if you think about personalization, right, they're the ones who've taken very early steps in driving personalization at scale, and doing so, though, kind of on that one-to-one basis, right, being able to take a lot of the data that they're capturing, within their walled gardens, and using that to drive kind of better experiences for people, whether coming onto their news feeds or they're using their mobile app or whatever it might be. But it can't be just, you know, unregulated, unmitigated control of how that data should be used. I think, you know, consumers today, especially in the wake of recent history, are starting to ask for more transparency in kind of those personalization algorithms, more control over how their personal data is being used. And then now you're seeing, you know, companies and social media companies like Snapchat, that their whole premise is about providing control upfront to their users in the way that they're driving, in the way that the users are interacting with their apps and communicating with their friends and whatnot, right? You have much more control in terms of how long a message can be on, can be there before it evaporates. You have much more control in terms of who that message goes to. And I think it's really interesting to see the evolution of that experience being driven by consumers' needs and wants to wanting more transparency and control. And that, and it really comes back, I think, Doc, to a fundamental thing is, you know, why is it so hard to build trust? And this is a question that we ask ourselves. We talk to, you know, we ask the industry at large and when we're having conversations with our clients. And I'd say, you know, when you think about building trust, it really is kind of a, it's really pretty much a two-sided coin. One is really first off on the customer's perspective, and we've talked a lot about this, but fundamentally, customers lack the transparency and control of their personal data and its use. You know, they can't see their profile data, they can't see where their likes and interests are in a single place. They don't know what they've signed up for, but you know, you could be inundated with receiving, you know, tons of different, you know, emails and email newsletters that you had no idea that you actually subscribed for, and trying to unsubscribe for them is even harder. Actually, Doc, you have a great story on this, on just being able to, your frustrations with the whole notion of how you're being marketed and communicated to. Talk a little bit about that.
Well, a couple of things. One is the slide that you're showing right now is actually a really good diagram for what the customer is going to have in the first place in their control. In other words, I have a place where I know where all my profile data is and who I've shared it with, what companies I've got a living connection with and which ones I don't, who I'm hearing from daily, weekly, or monthly, what the different terms that have been agreed to are, how I can change them, when they change them, all that kind of stuff. I mean, the reason the customer can't see and can't control that is because all of those things are different for the thousands of companies that we deal with. I have 900 different logins and passwords at this point that I've accumulated. Most of them are expired at this point, I suppose, or they're duplicates or some other thing. But, you know, imagine, you know, a woman changes or gets married, changes her last name. If you change your credit card is fraud, and all of a sudden, oh my God, you have to change it with everybody you're dealing with. You need to be able to do that easily with everybody, not going from one company to another. So part of the problem is that every company's doing this differently. And that is a real issue for us. It's sort of, imagine if, you know, if every store that we go to when we drive requires that we drive a different car there, and they're in charge of the car. It just makes no sense. And everybody is, you know, marketers love to talk about the customer journey. There isn't a single customer who thinks they're in a journey. There's certainly not a single customer who thinks they want to be in a funnel, which is another one of those awful words that marketers love to use, you know, like, oh my God, that's a cattle chute. I mean, who wants to be in that? And so there's a really good diagram of the customer journey done by a CRM guy named Esteban Kolsky, where he takes the circular version of the journey where you're buying on this side and you're owning it on the other side, then you dump it and you get another one, whatever it is. And he twists it into a figure eight that has on one side buy and on the other side own. And the customer, the marketer experience looks at that figure eight with buy on one side and own on the other as gigantic on the buy side and tiny on the own side. And they're detached. Once somebody owns something, you're scraping that off on the call center. The customer, on the other hand, it's completely reversed. Everything they own is on the right side or on the own side, and they're buying only a tiny percentage of the time. And this is part of the dysfunction that we have in the marketplace and with marketing in general, which is that is the assumption that you are buying something at all the time. I mean, you know, you go on Google Maps and you're looking for, you're doing research, you're looking for the height of Mount Washington, and it gives you all the hotels there. Well, now you're not looking for the hotels. You're looking for the height of Mount Washington, right? But the assumption is, oh, you're in the market for a hotel. You're in the market for this or that. When in fact, we're not. But we're owning things all the time, and we need service for things all the time. And where do we go for that? And the actual experience of being a customer is far more an experience of owning and renting and having a relationship with companies that are already trusted than it is of dealing with somebody trying to sell something at you all the time. So I want to go back and visit with that in mind, something you brought up earlier about transparency and algorithms. Facebook itself can't be transparent about its algorithm. Nobody inside it really knows what it does. When they were being, you know, hauled in front of Congress to talk about their you know, how the Russians use them. Something one of the guys there said was, and it was hardly noticed by the people reporting on it, was that the guy said, well, we really don't have much visibility below the account level. In other words, we can tell who's advertising, but we don't know what they're doing with it because we've got a machine. He didn't say this, but this is the implication. We've got a machine that allows anybody, millions of customers, of their customers, B2B customers, to selectively aim at, you know, the Audi driver in a given zip code, you know, who votes Republican or something, or might vote Republican, plus 10 other variables, and they can't go back and find those. And they don't even know what all the combinatorial, I mean, the variables are so infinitely wide that it's impossible for them to know that. And yet there have to be better ways to deal with customers than what that algorithm provides. And this touches on another point we may or may not want to go into, but I'll just put it out there, which is that it's very, very easy to focus on the giants, especially Facebook and Google. And they are going to be in trouble. And I think Snapchat, as I'll agree, that they're doing it much better than those other two are. But these are temporary effects. I mean, these are projects. They're not companies like General Motors. I mean, I was in broadcasting for many years, for a number of years anyway, and it always bothered me back then that at a radio station, our customers and our consumers were different populations, and we were detached from the listeners, we were detached from the viewers, because our customers were the people advertising at them, and that made us kind of deaf, dumb, and blind to what the market actually wanted, and we see this right now, for example, with Netflix. Netflix has no marketing in it at all, other than, hey, you watch this movie, you might want to watch this other movie. But beyond that, there's no advertising, there's no interruption. And Netflix now has more customers than all of cable television. How'd that happen? Well, it's because it's a somewhat marketing-free zone. And I think that's a sobering thought for marketers to take up. What is it the customer actually might want here, that isn't just blind guesswork, but actually is a response to a clear signal that we're looking for X, Y, or Z.
Yeah, and that's, you know, these are all great points. And to that end, I know for our listeners and viewers on the call, right, a lot of you are organizations today that have direct relationships with your consumers. And for you, you're asking, you know, how can we do, frankly, a better job in building these trusted relationships? How can we bring more transparency and control? Well, one is definitely around, you know, what can you do for a consumer? I think the next thing is the fact that businesses are really at risk at falling out of compliance. And especially when you think about GDPR itself, GDPR really requires you to have the burden of proof that consent was obtained in that correct and explicit manner, right? That's their responsibility. But the problem is there's so many challenges. There's challenges in the fact that today organizations have a hard time proving that they actually capture the consent. We talked about GDPR as one of the key regulations. I know I saw a question coming up on the chat. There are evolving regulations that are requiring that you are able to manage how you're using, storing, and processing that consumer data. Definitely in China and in Russia, they now have data residency laws requiring that their citizens' data stay within their motherland borders. You have Australia that's growing its regulatory environment. You have Canada that has CAN-SPAM and is continuing to monitor how consumer data is being used. And then the next thing that businesses face is the fact that even if they've captured consent, maybe it came in through one of their marketing technology solutions, they then can't enforce that consent consistently across their ecosystems. And so really what we're finding that, you know, the big kind of need out there in the market is, you know, can you have as an organization a holistic approach to securely capture preference and consent, right, that addresses regional privacy and compliance throughout that customer relationship, throughout the life cycle of the customer. And there's some core things that you do need, right? Yes, you need to be able to have to be ready in the event that you are audited. You need to be able to track and monitor the fact that consent is being captured correctly. You do need to be able to enforce that consent, and you also need to be able to provide that self-service preference center, if you will, that a consumer has direct access to their profile information, to their preferences, and to what they've consented to. And so Gigya has really looked at this from the perspective holistically, not only talking with many of our organizations and clients as they're preparing themselves for GDPR, but also just being able to take a look at the market at large and where kind of this groundswell movement is going. And we're actually really excited to be able to offer kind of a holistic approach in not only being able to capture a consumer identity, you know, at that point of interaction with your website or your mobile app, or even if you're interfacing between a device and a user, but being able to capture that and manage it so that you could drive better personalization, drive better customer experience, use that as part of your overall kind of intelligence and analytics to determine what new services you need to offer. But we also are able to provide our organizations the ability to manage that consent, manage those preferences in a privacy compliant manner throughout the life cycle of the customer. And in order to do this, it is fundamentally founded on the fact that you have a strong identity foundation, that you have identity that can be captured as early as possible in that customer journey, and that you're managing that identity, you're building rich profiles on top of that identity, and you're doing so in an opted-in, consented manner. And so if I think about what we offer in terms of an enterprise preference manager, it's really about managing that consent throughout the life cycle of the customer. And it is constitutes some kind of four core pillars. The first is around presenting and capturing that preference and consent. And let's talk about the different ways and the different styles that you can do that. Well, one is obviously we talked about this kind of early on in the customer journey, is that awareness. You know, that first time you come to a website, you know, that cookie consent is popping up in front of you, and you have to accept it. Well, we absolutely can capture that cookie consent and store that within our system. We also are able through our, when a customer is at that point of creating an account, oftentimes on a website or a mobile app, you have to accept terms of service and the privacy policies that are associated with using that digital property and the services and the products that are going to come with. Obviously, we can present that and capture those terms of service, but there's other things too. There's things like marketing communications or custom activities. You know, at that time of account creation, you may ask, would you like to sign up for a newsletter and receive some kind of daily notification? You must be able to ask for that consent, and you have to be able to capture that consent. Even if today you want to be able to use kind of custom data attributes like location data to help determine how you want to communicate or market to somebody, you need to now get consent in order to use that location data for that specific purpose. And then let's not forget frequency. Frequency is one that I know I really care about, and one that I think our clients need to really understand. And what frequency means is, you know, it's not that I just got your consent that I could send you a newsletter, but I need to get your consent for how frequently you want to receive it. So it's so funny how many times we accept terms of service policies today, and all of a sudden, embedded in that terms of service is the fact that you can receive a newsletter. Well, you don't know how frequently that newsletter comes. All of a sudden, it's like mushrooms popping up in your inbox. You go from one email to once a week to now emails daily, and then emails daily across different topics that brand wants to communicate with you. That practice is going to have to get cleaned up by organizations, and they're going to now have to get explicit consent. So there's this next pillar, being able to maintain accurate consent, and to do so, terms of services changes, version numbers of those policies change, and so you need to be able to re-trigger consent, capture that consent renewal, and capture the history of that consent so that you can audit it at time. then, and when you have that accurate consent, right, the next core thing that we talked about that oftentimes gets overlooked is enforcing that consent, synchronizing those preferences, consent, and profile data to downstream marketing, sales, and services applications. And to the point that Doc made earlier around, you know, it isn't just about, you know, heavy emphasis on the buy and the conversion, as I know most organizations really think about, but it's also what happens post-sale and maintaining that relationship with the customer, looking at the retention of that customer, and knowing that consent, you have taken on the responsibility to enforce that consent into the other solutions that are directly communicating with your users. And then lastly is that user control of their preferences and their consent. Having the user be able to go to an intuitive user interface about when they log on and they authenticate into their account profile information, they could view their profile, they could change and modify their profile data, their preferences, and also very importantly, their consent. What they can withdraw their consent, and then they can enact the individual rights that we were talking about earlier with that GDPR require. And when you think about what customers want, you know, when they think about transparency and control, that interface is really important, right? You need to be able to have a place where they could go and modify their PII information, right? They changed their phone number, they got a new number, they maybe changed addresses. They need to be able to do that, and they need to be able to do that on their own. Then to be able to see very clearly, well, what have I consented to? What are the privacy policies I've consented? When have I consented to that? As well as, let me give permission to the personal data that I have. Let me ensure that if I want them to use my full name, I allow them to use my full name, right? And then lastly, and the thing that I talked about is communication preferences. Help me understand what am I receiving in terms of communication, and at what frequency am I receiving it? And this is something that Gigya now offers as part of our enterprise preference manager solution. And even though we talked about this, I think it's always important to think about this problem globally. Many of our viewers and listeners today are global organizations. You operate in multiple markets and geographies. And so with that, you must also be able to stay in compliance with not only the larger kind of cross-border type of regulations, but also your regional privacy regulations. So when you think about how you're setting up your digital property, when you think about how you're interacting digitally with your consumer, you need to also think about those regional terms of service, those regional data privacy layers, and you need to be able to have something that could centrally manage that across all of your markets and geos, and enforce that across your regional systems and solutions. And so this is really kind of the core, I think, today that we wanted to talk about, is as you're looking at GDPR, as you're thinking about how to better manage your customer data, and how you're thinking about how to drive personalization. And I'd say personalization done right, it really fundamentally is based on the fact that you're building a trusted relationship between you and your consumers, and that's founded on transparency and control. And so, kind of with that, I know we have just a few minutes left, Doc. And so, I want to actually take this opportunity now to transition this into Q&A. I know we have a lot of questions coming through, so let's go ahead and do that now and see if we could tackle some of these.
Sure.
Yeah. Sorry. all right. So we have kind of a comment here that maybe we can discuss from a listener. It's GDPR encourages a worse journey for the customer/consumer if they reject consent. They will get a clunky experience for those customers who just accept the terms, like most people do, will have the best experience. The trade-off is a little bit of data exchange. What do you guys think on that?
Well, first of all, I would dispute the notion that we trade data for anything. I think that's a marketing convention to look at it that way, but I don't think that's what people actually experience. They, you know, they you know, they go to a store, they interact with the store, they leave, they don't think they've exchanged any data, whether that happens online or off. I think that the only answer to this in the long run is full control on the customer side. Everything that we just saw as part of Gigya's offering, that's my wish list as a customer. You know, I want to have, here are my fields. I've just changed my last name. I'm going to change it with everybody. Here are my terms. Here's everybody who's agreed to them. Here's the consent I've given. Here's, you know, we need tools on our side. I actually think Gigya is probably in a better position than anybody to help us do that. But as long as we only look at this in terms of the norms that currently exist on the side of marketing, we're not going to get to the answers that the market needs. So, and that's sort of, I'm trying to address some of the other questions as well, because it's so normative right now to think that the system that we have now is going to persist but I don't think it is. I think that's one of the reasons that the GDPR itself is a bit of an extinction event.
Very good. Very, yeah, agreed. And I would say totally agree with you there, with you there, Doc. And as I take a look here at some of the other questions as well. So let's see. You know, I think there's a lot of questions around ad technology and DMPs and whatnot. And instead of tackling them individually, I think I just like to answer it holistically. To the point of this is for any ad tech and even marketing technology where you're capturing consumer data. There needs to be a reevaluation on how you're taking a look at capturing that data, how you're getting consent for that data, and then how are you using that data responsibly. And again, this is largely driven not only by regulations like GDPR, but I think a growing demand from consumers that this is what they want. They want more transparency and control. So for those types of technologies today that really don't deal in that opted-in, self-volunteered information, and where they're relying on things like cookie ID or mobile ad IDs to stitch together who somebody is, to stitch together what audience segments are, and then to use that to market against people, they're going to really have to take a look and see what are they going to be able to do to address regulations like GDPR. I don't know what their answer is, but I think that they're going to have to take a serious look at it and then come up with the right solution. In the interim, we understand here at Gigya, we are built from the ground up with that customer-first approach, working directly with users in that self-volunteered, opted-in way. The data that we're capturing is that first-party, deterministic, opted-in data. And from there, that's how we build and continue to build the relationship, help our clients continue to build relationships with their consumers. So I think that is about the time that we have. I know we're over the hour. This has been an exhilarating conversation, Doc. I really appreciate the insights that you brought to the table. I hope everybody online enjoyed this hour of time. And with that, I'd like to conclude today's webinar. I really appreciate everyone's joining. And just to let you know, this webinar will be available on demand should you want to re-listen to it or should you want to forward it on to your colleagues. Okay. So thank you for that. And everyone have a great day. Thanks again, Doc.
Thank you. Really appreciate it.
All right. Thank you both. And everyone have a good day.